Cinnamon, where you gonna run to? Cinnamon, where you gonna run to?
Following Sarah's suicide, my relationship with the God of my youth began to turn into a kind of question with no answers session. I worked on trying to reconcile my belief with the world I saw around me, and while my body still functioned and moved through the motions of being alive, my apathy towards the world actually led me to pull my head out of my shell, find a bit of who cares confidence, and I started to see the person I would become if I could just hold on to something worthwhile and meaningful. The relationship with the girl I had sex with was what I thought I needed to hold on to, and while I can look back and see that it was merely my attempt at holding on as tight as I could so she would never be taken from me, that relationship caused a couple of decisions that my current self wishes he could slap my then self for making. After graduating from my private Christian school in June of 1996, I moved in with my grandparents so I could be out from under my parents' rule for the summer before going off to college. My intention was to complete a bachelor's degree program in history with a pre-law emphasis, and then follow up with law school somewhere after that. As a kid, I went through the regular gamut of ideas and wanted to be a fireman, a stuntman, a train conductor, an Air Force pilot, or maybe a cowboy somewhere in Montana. But then somewhere between 200 and 300 episodes of Matlock and Perry Mason, I decided I wanted to spend the days of my life working in the justice system as a lawyer. I now know that the TV and movie versions of lawyers are glorified, to say the least, but at the time that's the path that I chose. That summer before going to college, I lived a rather carefree life. My walk with God and my religious beliefs took a backseat to just having fun, and while I still had a few rules living with my grandparents, there was no overseer, which is what I was used to. I spent a lot of time with my girlfriend, the same one that I had sex with for the first time, and I went to church on Sundays, hungover for the most part. I'm not sure exactly what I was thinking, and my journal actually kind of drops dead silent for a few years around this period. But I think that I was just doing what most people do when they move from an overly oppressive environment into a more free environment. I started to live. As a quick side note, to give everyone a good example of what the Christian dogma and brainwashing can do to a person, I just wanted to note that when I did have sex for the first time the year prior with this girl that's now my girlfriend, I immediately felt so much guilt and pain at my actions that I actually cried right then and there. After that, I prayed with her. So talk about fucked up. I was so sheltered and so completely brain dead and so unprepared for anything the real world had to offer. I was like a baby playing in traffic, or like that kid that finally gets a hit in T-ball and then runs the wrong way. I had no clue what I was doing, what any of it meant, and how it would affect me. What I can see now is that I was unable to grasp the proper meaning of so many actions I did and saw, and so my reactions were to take them to an unhealthy extreme. My relationship with this girl is Exhibit A. I can see in the spotty journal entries and remember in my mind the weeks of anguish after we had sex where I thought that she was just as torn up over having sex as I was. What I didn't know was that she was really only upset because she felt that it was her fault for me being upset, and she kind of felt like I had made such a big deal out of it that she had kind of spoiled a pure thing. I reread the journal entries from that time period so many times in the last couple of weeks trying to get back into the head of that kid, but there was so much confusion and so many religious beliefs damning my actions. There were so many excuses, so many promises to never sin again. It's just a mess, and I really can't figure it out, to be honest. So fall finally came, and I packed up my 86 Ford Escort with all I wanted to take to college and headed across the country. My college of choice? Oral Roberts University in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Now, I had visited ORU many times over the past 2 years, as both of my sisters were attending college there, and on one specific occasion, I was walking through the campus at night and praying for guidance from God. I wasn't sure if that was where I needed to go, and I was hoping that God would give me a nudge in the right direction. Now, realistically, I hadn't even seriously applied or even visited any other college, so the voice in my head that told me I should go to ORU probably wasn't God, but my own brain telling me that I just needed to go to college. Not necessarily go to college there, but of course at the time, I thought it was God telling me that. Arriving for registration, I was blown away at how many people were there. My graduating class at high school had only been about 120, so seeing a couple thousand people moving their stuff into dorms, standing in lines, getting their student IDs, signing up for classes, etc., it was a bit overwhelming. And then while I was making my rounds with my parents and sisters, meeting new people, meeting my roommate, figuring out where everything was, I was introduced to Mary. I took her hand in a friendly greeting and saw in her eyes that I wasn't the only one that felt it. It was love at first sight. Now don't worry, this isn't another tragic slap to the face of reality like part 3 and 4, because I can guarantee you that I would not be here to tell you my story if that had happened again so soon. As the first days of college life moved us through the chapel meetings, the class introductions, buying books, finding out where the best pizza came from, if we were going to get along with our roommates or end up killing them, I saw Mary from time to time, and it basically just reinforced the feeling that God had sent me to ORU for a reason beyond my understanding. My roommate and I talked endlessly about living in a dorm room together and adjusting to not having privacy for certain, activities? Not sex, per se, as the dorms at ORU aren't co-ed, and guys couldn't go into the girls' rooms and vice versa. But those other activities that you do when you're alone? Right. Anyway, we talked about how after we got to college, neither of us really even had the desire to partake in such a worldly pleasure, so in the end it wasn't even an issue. We talked about a lot of things like that, and one of the keys was that right before leaving for college, I had decided that I was going to rededicate my life to God. I was going to go to college with a fresh spirit and a renewed sense of right and wrong. I told my girlfriend that God wanted me to go to this college and that I needed to go. She didn't want me to, she didn't want to come along and find a job so she could be close to me, but in the end, she understood that I wanted and felt as though I needed to move out there and go to college. When I got to ORU, I found a few wingmates that were of the same mind. We were all turning back to God and letting our bad habits fall away so that we could live our lives the way that we were told that we should and the way that we had been taught that we needed to. I honestly don't know if I gave up trying to be good before, or if it was the moment I spent that evening in the dark of the college garden with Mary that I started going back on my old ways. But any way you look at it, it didn't last. Mary and I became inseparable, and although she knew I had a girlfriend back in Ohio, we didn't really talk about it, and soon we were physical when we could find time to be off campus with each other. We took lots of walks through Woodward Park in Tulsa, and that was followed by fogging up the windows of my car, and then exasperated sighs when we took the time to look at the clock and head back to campus to meet curfew. My studies were going well for a couple of months, and I think that a lot of that was my desire to stay close to Mary for as long as I could. Then my girlfriend from Ohio came to visit. She stayed in a hotel across from campus, and while I couldn't spend the night due to my curfew, I did take her out to dinner and back to her hotel, where we were intimate, and I actually felt her pain at being so far away from me. I was an asshole for doing what I was doing with Mary, I know that. And the guilt of what I had been doing drilled into my heart the moment I realized how hard it was for my girlfriend to be separated from me. And this is where things got interesting. Instead of believing, as I did, that God was right in telling me that I needed to be at ORU, and instead of ending things with my girlfriend and ending what would be another year of pain for both of us that would have allowed me to follow my feelings, stay at college, get a degree, and pursue a relationship with a girl that I had a healthy relationship with, I started to shut down and I shut out everybody at college. I stopped going to classes. I told Mary that I couldn't see her anymore, and when she said she wanted to just keep things platonic, I got angry and told her that I couldn't even do that, and that I didn't even want to talk to her anymore. Heading downhill faster than a skier, I became a hermit, spent a fortune on long-distance phone calls to Ohio, got a few calls from professors wondering why I wasn't showing up to class, I stopped talking to my roommate. A couple of the other guys that had decided that we were going to live our lives for God kind of made the same turn away from God as I did around that time, and we all used to drive to the other side of town to smoke cigars, check out nudie magazines. And then on the final week of the first semester of my college career, I packed up all of my belongings. I didn't tell anybody I was leaving other than my sisters and my roommate who found out, and went to the admissions office to remove myself from the school. Although I can't say that I regret what I did, because that implies that I didn't learn anything from it, I am still upset as I look back through the clarity of time and see the rash decisions that would shape the next 10 years of my life. Within 3 months of moving back to Ohio and working random odd jobs and living with my grandparents again, my girlfriend informed me that she was pregnant. In my anger at being so fooled by a God that told me to go to ORU so I could taste what love was actually supposed to be, and then watch it fall apart with no divine intervention, I went against everything I believed at that point and press my girlfriend into having an abortion. You see, the ghosts that haunt me are of my own making. I've been working on transferring whole movies from tapes to digital for my mom, and seeing the anger and rage on my face and hearing it in my voice as I interact with my family that first Christmas home in 1996 is so strange, because I know that is the same me that my family got to see for the next 10 years or so. It was Easter Sunday of 1997, after the abortion and after finally breaking up with my girlfriend, that I finally turned all of my rage at God. In the middle of the service, I walked out the front door, slammed the door, and headed out to live my life the way I wanted to, the way I felt it should be lived, the way I would eventually learn was just as unhealthy as continuing along the same lines I had been told by my parents and my pastor that I should. Hindsight is 20/20. I know that. But the actions I took as a teenager were questionable even to that teenager. I knew I was being irrational in how I treated my girlfriend, how I treated Mary, how I treated my family, and how I started to treat myself. The confidence I had gained by not caring anymore after Sarah's death was replaced by a self-loathing that I still can't get over. I honestly and truthfully hate my past. I hate that there was no good, believable, positive influence in my life. I hate that I was the one that became the Swami for all my friends and acquaintances, while I was left to ponder the top of the mountain all on my own. This is the end of this series, as I have plans for a series about my 20s, and then I'll work on my deconversion story. I've noticed as I continue to type and record these videos that this is really just my memoir, the one I never had a reason to tell, the one I never had the motivation to tell, the one I never thought anyone would give a shit about. So I just wanted to thank everyone for sticking through the series, and I hope to make the next series just as interesting and entertaining. Until next time, I'm Xander's Meteor. Have a good one.